Hello everyone, you're watching Sahab Academy, and if you're here to get your topic simplified, then believe me, you are in the right place. So let's start the video and let's get on with it. Welcome back everyone to the fifth video of consolidation chapter. Today we are going to understand how to deal with intra-group transactions in consolidated financial statements. But first let's understand what are intra-group transactions. So see, it's really simple. These are those transactions which takes place within the boundary of the group. What's a group? Holding company, all its subsidiaries, joint ventures and associates. So whatever transaction that takes place within this boundary among these parties, those transactions would be classified as intra-group transactions. Simple as that. Now there are many names to this: intercompany transactions, mutual owings, intercompany balances. You can call whatever you want, fine. But here in this video series, we are going to refer it as intra-group transaction because that's what our study module calls it, fine. So let's take an example to understand this even further. Let's say Reliance Industries sold something on credit to Alok Industries. So of course, this transaction would be classified as what? Intra-group transaction, because Reliance Industries is the holding company and Alok Industries is its subsidiary. So this transaction is a transaction within the group, so it's called as intra-group transaction. So now what will happen of this transaction? Understand properly. The accountants of Reliance Industries and Alok Industries will record this transaction in their separate books. And later, of course, it will appear in their financial statements. Here the purchase will go to statement of profit and loss. Here the sale will also go to statement of profit and loss. And as I said, this is a credit transaction. So of course, Reliance Industries have to receive the money. So they will recognize a debtor, and Alok Industries has to pay. So they have to recognize a creditor in their balance sheets. Isn't it? So in the balance sheet of Reliance Industries, they have to record, let's say 5 lakh is the amount. So 5 lakh of debtors they have to recognize an asset, and Alok Industries will recognize 5 lakh of liability, creditors, right? So this is fine as long as we are talking about separate financial statement, standalone financial statement, because these are separate entities. Yeah, they are doing their operations business separately. Yeah, and they have their own separate financial statements. So of course, they will record whatever the transaction and events are taking place in their separate companies. But when it comes to consolidated financial statement, the same thing will not work. Why? See here, in consolidated financial statements, all effects of common transactions, intra-group transactions, intercompany transaction should be eliminated by each other. But why it should be eliminated? Because the whole group, what are we doing? In consolidation chapter, we are preparing consolidated financial statements. Yeah, we are combining all the financial statements of all the, you know, the companies. So if you are combining everything, then this whole thing will be called as one single economic entity, Reliance Industries Group. So this is a single economic entity, and these intra-group transactions cannot exist in that. See here, because the whole group, holding, subsidiary, joint venture and associates, is considered a single economic entity, and a single economic entity cannot do transaction with itself. It cannot do trading with itself. Yeah. So whatever the common transactions, intercompany balances, mutual owings, whatever you want, you can call it, those things are there. Those must be eliminated in CFS, but it will exist in standalone financial statements, as I said. Yeah, that example which I gave you, of course they will record asset and liability in their balance sheet. Yeah, for example, let's say Reliance Industries, and this is the Alok Industries balance sheet. So Reliance has recorded we have to receive 5 lakh from subsidiary company, and subsidiary company saying in the balance sheet we have to pay 5 lakh to the Reliance Industries. Yeah, so this is fine as long as we are talking about standalone financial statements. But when it comes to consolidated balance sheet, consolidated financial statement, where we combine everything and we consider the whole group a single economic entity, then what are we going to do? We are going to cancel the common balances, the common transactions, everything will be cancelled. So that same amount will be cancelled. It will not be taken into the consolidated balance sheet. 5 lakh, 5 lakh, cancel. In consolidated balance sheet, you will show other debtors and other creditors to the third parties, not within the group. Yeah, for example, let's say here there was debtors of 7 lakhs and here there were creditors of, let's say, 8 lakh. So what are you going to do? Whatever common is there to holding and subsidiary, let's say 5 lakh, 5 lakh was common. So that 5 lakh, 5 lakh will be eliminated. And then the remaining, whatever that is there to third party, that will be consolidated together in consolidated balance sheet. Is that clear? Fine. So this is what will happen. Now there are many different types of intra-group transactions, you know. I just gave you an example of debtor and creditor here. Yeah, you understood how you're going to cancel regarding that. But there is one more important thing in that, that's called cash in transit, which you have to understand properly, and we'll do that. Okay, so we'll see that later. And then one more thing is loan given to one company to another. This is also intra-group transaction, isn't it? Holding company has given loan to subsidiary company, just for an example. So of course, this is happening within the group and it will exist in the balance sheet, standalone financial statement. That's fine. But when it comes to consolidated balance sheet, it cannot exist because the group, the single company, cannot give loan to itself. There is no difference over here between holding and subsidiary. It's same. Yeah, the group, one group is considered a single economic entity. So how one single economic entity can give loan to itself? It cannot. So that's why you have to cancel these transactions. Yeah, loan given and loan taken, asset liability, you have to cancel them. It will not be taken in the consolidated balance sheet. Is that clear? Same with the bills receivable and bills payable also. Asset liability, just cancel it off. But here there is one more, you know, concept called as contingent liability. So we are going to go in very much depth of this bills receivable and bills payable, and we're going to understand with couple of examples. Okay, let's do that. So you understood, right? Intra-group transactions are those transactions which happen within the boundary of the group, and whatever that exists in the balance sheet, the common things, you must eliminate them in consolidated balance sheet. Okay, see here, treatment: cancel mutual owings, intra-group transactions, while preparing consolidated balance sheet. These are mutual owings, isn't it? 5 lakh, you know, they have to receive 5 lakh, they have to pay. Yeah, so they owe to each other, so that's why you have to cancel that. Simple as that. Fine. So now let's take a couple of examples to understand regarding the treatment of bill receivable and bills payable, and then we'll see debtor and creditor and all. Okay, fine. Now here we have the steps that we have to follow when we get this bills of exchange adjustment. So see, it's really simple. The first step is you have to identify what are the total bills that have been issued within the group. Yeah, you have to identify the common bills between holding and subsidiary. Okay, and then in the second step, you have to cancel the assets and liabilities of bills issued and still held within the group. What does this mean? It means you have to cancel only those bills which still exist in the balance sheet of both the companies, holding as well as subsidiary. Only that you can eliminate, only that you can cancel. Let's understand till here with the first example. Okay, so see here, in this example we have these two companies, holding and subsidiary, and in their balance sheets you can see in holding you have bills receivable balance of 18,000, and in subsidiary balance sheet you have balance of bills payable of 12,000. And in additional information, it is being said subsidiary company accepted bills payable of 2,000 in favor of holding company. So now what can you understand from this? You can understand from this additional information that the common bills, yeah, the bills issued within the group is of 2,000. Yes, the bills issued within the group are 2,000, isn't it? That's what you do, right? Identify bills issued within the group. So that is 2,000. And you have to cancel, in the second step, you have to cancel assets and liabilities, BR and BP, of the bills which are issued and still held. So is this 2,000 still held? Is this 2,000 still exist in both the balance sheet? Of course it is. This 2,000 exists in this 18,000 and in this 12,000. Yeah. So what you have to do, just cancel it out. You just have to do contra elimination. Cancel, cancel. So how will you do that? See here, you will take bills payable 12,000. Okay. And bills receivable 18,000, assets and liabilities. And you will just do contra elimination of the common bills, that is 2,000 minus 2,000 minus 2,000. Why did you take 2,000? Because it is issued and still held. It is there in the balance sheet, right? So minus 2,000 minus 2,000, what did you get? 10,000 as the bills payable over here, and bills receivable 16,000. So these bills, 10,000 and 16,000, these worth of bills are to the third party, which can exist in the consolidated balance sheet. But intercompany bills, intra-group transaction bills, cannot exist. That's why we contra eliminated them. So just cancel whatever is common and exists in the balance sheet. That 2,000 existed in both the balance sheet, so we could easily do contra elimination. Minus 2,000, minus 2,000 in holding as well as subsidiary. Yeah, that's what we did, isn't it? In consolidated balance sheet, right? So till the second step you understood. Now you have to understand the third step. Yeah, what if there are contingent liabilities? Now why there would be contingent liabilities, you have to understand the entire background. So let's do that. See here, let's understand the concept of contingent liability in bills of exchange. So in the second step, we saw that we could easily cancel the common bills and the bills which exist in both the balance sheet. Yeah, if 15,000 is there, yeah, common bills between holding and subsidiary, 15,000 worth of bills, and both still exist in the balance sheet, BR 15,000, BP 15,000, then you can easily do contra elimination in the consolidated balance sheet, -15,000, -15,000. Yeah, you can do that. But sometime what will happen? Sometime there will be contingent liability. You have to understand that. So see, let's say there are these two companies, holding and subsidiary, and let's say the common bills between them, the bills issued were 15,000 worth of bills. So holding company had bills receivable balance of 15,000 previously, and subsidiary had bills payable balance 15,000 balance, okay, of bills payable, right? So now what happened was, holding company could not wait till the maturity when subsidiary company will pay the money on the bill. Yeah, it could not wait till the maturity of the bill. So what holding company did was, it went to the bank and discounted the bill and got the money immediately. Yes. So now what will happen when the bill is discounted? The bank will get the BR. Yeah, the bank will get the BR, and bank will wait till the maturity and will get the money from subsidiary, 15,000. Yeah, that's what will happen. But now when the bill is discounted, holding company will immediately remove the balance from its own balance sheet, standalone balance sheet, because it does not have the bill, right? The bill is with the bank, so it will remove that balance, okay? But it will recognize a contingent liability of 15,000. Why is that? Understand properly. If subsidiary company fails to pay 15,000 on the maturity, if bank does not get 15,000 from subsidiary company, then bank will come back to the holding company. See, give me my money back, because your subsidiary company did not pay money on that bill. I did not get my 15,000. So you have to pay me back 15,000. That's what will happen. So when holding company discounted the bill, it removed the asset from over here in separate financial statement, because it does not have the bill, but it recognized the contingent liability that if subsidiary company doesn't pay, then I have to pay to the bank. If subsidiary company does not pay, then I have to pay to the bank. There is no present obligation. You cannot take, you know, an actual liability. No, it's a contingent liability, a liability which may or may not arise, and that may or may not is dependent upon the third party, subsidiary company. Yeah, it is dependent upon a future event of some third party. Okay, so that's why holding company had to recognize a contingent liability, which is not, you know, which does not exist in the balance sheet. It is below the balance sheet. It is not part of double entry. Okay, so this contingent liability has been recognized of 15,000. Why it has been recognized? Because the liability may arise in future if subsidiary company fails to pay. See here, because if subsidiary company fails to pay on the maturity of the bill, then bank will come back and catch holding company that, see holding company, I did not get the bill, so you have to pay me 15,000. So liability is dependent upon outcome of future event. There is no present obligation. Direct actual liability cannot be recognized. A contingent liability will be recognized in standalone financial statement. Okay, so on the consolidation date, this will be the position that subsidiary company has the balance, bills payable 15,000, but holding company does not have the balance of 15,000. Why? Because the holding company maybe have discounted the bill, or it has endorsed the bill to its creditors. Yeah, that can also happen, endorsement of the bill. Yeah, because of endorsement or discounting of the bill, the BR balance is not there. Yeah, that's what will happen. Whoever has bills receivable, either they can discount or they can endorse. Yeah, and they will have to remove. If they do that, then they will have to remove it from their balance sheet, but recognize a contingent liability. If, for example, if holding had endorsed the bill of that 15,000, then what they have to do? They have to recognize a contingent liability of 15,000. And if subsidiary failed to pay, then that liability will materialize. That liability will become actual liability. That liability, contingent liability, will become actual liability. If subsidiary company fails to pay, the creditor will come back. See, holding company, I did not get my money from subsidiary on that bill, so I was your creditor, you have to pay me 15,000. Is that clear? So this is what will happen. So now, this was all about standalone financial statement. This was all about standalone financial statements. The entire logic behind contingent liability. Now you have to understand what will happen in consolidated balance sheet. In consolidated balance sheet, when we have like this position, contingent liability 15,000, BR is not there, here BP 15,000 is there, bills are issued of 15,000 but not held by one company, not held. Bills are issued but not held. What you will do regarding this? What you have to do is, it's very simple. You will take BP as it is. You will not touch the balance sheet. You will take BP as it is, and BR is not there. Yeah. So as it is, whatever third party BR is there, that you will take. But that BR 15,000 is not there, so you will not take that BR as it is. You will just take the consolidated balance sheet. But contingent liability you will have to eliminate. 15,000 contingent liability minus contra elimination 15,000. No contingent liability. Just reduce the contingent liability. You have to eliminate that. But you will not do contra elimination in the balance sheet. You will not touch BP and BR. Whenever you have contingent liability, and in consideration to that, you will not touch BP and BR. That will be as it is. Understand properly. Now you have to understand the logic behind this. See, here I have written cancel contingent liabilities with bills issued but not held. Yeah, bills issued but not held was that 15,000. So in relation to that, you have to cancel contingent liability. Yeah, 15,000, but not with this BP. BP and that BR will be as it is. Is that clear? Yes. Because if you touch BP and BR, yeah, if you touch that regarding that contingent liability, if you touch the balance sheet, then balance sheet will not tally. So that's why you will not touch this. Just reduce the contingent liability. Now, what's the logic behind this? Why are we eliminating contingent liability? See, it's really simple. Understand over here. What happened in standalone financial statement? In standalone financial statement, the language was like this. If subsidiary company fails to pay, then I have to pay to the bank. Holding company saying, if subsidiary company fails to pay, then I will have to pay to the bank. I will have to pay to the creditors. Yeah, I discounted or I endorse. Yeah. So that's why contingent liability was there. The liability may or may not arise. Now, who is saying this? Holding company saying this. Yeah, because this company discounted or endorsed the bill, right? Now, if we are talking about consolidation, if we are talking from the group's point of view, yeah, the group's point of view, single economic entity, how can this entity say if subsidiary company fails to pay, then I will have to pay? No, it's not like that. In consolidation, there is no subsidiary, there is no holding. It's all one single economic entity, one single group. Yeah, one single group cannot say if subsidiary doesn't pay, I have to pay. Yeah, there is no may or may not. Yeah, that thing is not there in the group. It's a single economic entity. Who has to pay that? The group has to pay. Simple as that, period, full stop. Okay, you cannot say that if subsidiary doesn't pay, I will have to pay. No, it's not like that. That was fine when we were talking about separate financial statements, but in group's financial statement, the group is saying that we have to pay 15,000 as it is. There's no contingent liability in regarding this bills of exchange. Yeah, because see, bills payable 15,000, subsidiary has to pay 15,000, right? Subsidiary company has to be 15,000. When it is consolidated, the financial statements are consolidated, BR is not there. So a third party is involved over here. Who is the third party? Creditors. If endorsement has happened, if discounting has happened, then that's bank. So third party is there. So group has to pay to third party. It's not like an intra-group transaction really. Yeah, this bills payable, this 15,000 has to go to whom? It has to go to third party, bank or creditors. Discounting or endorsement, right? So a third party is involved. So that 15,000 liability has materialized. You can say it like that. Contingent liability is no more. You cannot take contingent liability because a third party is involved over here. Holding and subsidiary is one and the same only in consolidated balance sheet. You cannot say if subsidiary doesn't pay, I have to pay. That was fine in separate financial statement. In consolidation, in consolidated balance sheet, there is no difference between holding and subsidiary. It's all one and the same. A group, single economic entity. It's just that single economic entity has to pay to the third party, to the bank, to the creditor. Simple as that. So this contingent liability you have to eliminate, and BP will be recognized over here. I mean, as it is, you will keep it. Okay, but the behind the scenario is that this contingent liability is being eliminated because it is rotated off to, it is, you know, materializing over here as, you know, bills payable, actual liability. Fine, that's the logic. Is that clear? Do you understand this logic behind contingent liability? I gave you the entire behind the concept regarding this. Okay, fine. So now let's take an example of contingent liability and you will understand it even better. Now here we have the second example of bill of exchange, which is a bit more comprehensive with contingent liability and everything. So see, here we have been given these two companies and their balance sheet, holding balance sheet which has bills payable of 24,000 and subsidiary balance sheet which has bills receivable balance of 19,000, and at the below we have contingent liability of 2,000. Fine. And then in additional information, it is being said subsidiary company drew bill of exchange on holding company and later endorsed 2,000 worth of bills to its supplier. So from this sentence, we can understand that the company, subsidiary company, has endorsed 2,000 bills, 2,000 worth of bills. That's why, you know, here we have contingent liability of 2,000. Yeah, because if holding company does not pay, then subsidiary company will have to pay, right? Yes. And then see here, second point, bills payable appearing in holding balance sheet are the acceptance given to subsidiary company for a total amount of 21,000. Fine. So now what was our first step when we get this bills of exchange adjustment in the question? The first step is we have to identify the bills issued within the group. What are the common bills between holding and subsidiary company? Now that you can understand from the second point. Yeah. It's not 24,000, it's not 19,000. In the second point, it's specifically said, see here, bills payable appearing in holding balance sheet. Yeah, bills payable appearing in holding balance sheet are the acceptance given to subsidiary company for a total amount of 21,000. So in this 24,000, 21,000 is the acceptance given to subsidiary. So 21,000 is the common bills, are the common bills, and remaining 3,000 is to the third party. Okay, we are not concerned about that right now. So 21,000 is the common bills, but here there is no 21,000. Here it's only 19,000. Why it's 19,000? Think. Why it's 19,000? Because 2,000 worth of bills have been endorsed to the supplier, yeah, to the creditor of subsidiary. Yes. So that's why they are showing contingent liability over here. So you identified, right? 21,000 is the common bills, are the common bills. So now you have to understand how much of that 21,000 is still held and not held. Yeah. See the solution part over here. Bills issued within group is 21,000. From the second point, we understood that. And still held is how much? 19,000. How 19,000? Because not held is 2,000. So still held would be 19,000. See here. Not held is 2,000. So 21,000 minus 2,000, that is equal to 19,000, which is still held. Yeah, 19,000 is there in this balance sheet as well as in this balance sheet. 19,000 is there, right? In that 24,000. So 19,000 is there over here, also over here. So that's why not held is 2,000. Is that clear? So what you will do of still held? You will cancel. Of still held, you will cancel, na? See here, whatever that is common and still exists in both the balance sheet, you will just contra eliminate that. Minus 19,000 minus 19,000, that's what you will do regarding this still held. But of not held, what you will do? You will just reduce contingent liability, which will be there. Yeah, cancel contingent liability with bills issued but not held. Don't touch BRBP in balance sheet as regards to contingent liability. No contra elimination in balance sheet. Elimination will be there below the balance sheet, not in the balance sheet as regards to contingent liability. So see, it's very simple. Consolidated balance sheet, bills payable 24,000, bills receivable 19,000. Yeah. So you will do contra elimination of what? Contra elimination of only the common bills and which still exists in the balance sheet. What exists in the balance sheet? Understand, 19,000 exists. 19,000 exists. Only that you will cancel. Minus 19,000 minus 19,000. So here it became nil and here 5,000. So of this 5,000, now understand, 3,000 was directly third party. And the remaining 2,000 is what? 2,000 is also third party to the supplier. Yeah, see here. Understand behind the concept. See, in subsidiary what happened? Previously there was BR of 21,000. Yeah, in the beginning, BR of 21,000. Later, subsidiary company endorsed. Yeah, later subsidiary company endorsed the bill to its supplier. Yeah, so 2,000 was of bill was given to supplier. So they reduced the bills receivable from their standalone financial statement. They are showing only 19,000. But they had to show contingent liability now. Because if holding company failed to pay, then subsidiary company will have to pay separately to supplier. Yeah, that bill will not work, isn't it? So supplier is saying, if I don't get the money on this bill, on the maturity date of the bill, then I will come back to you subsidiary. I will catch the subsidiary and I will get my money back. Right. So that's why they recognize contingent liability in their standalone financial statement. but it cannot be recognized, contingent liability cannot be recognized in consolidated balance sheet, because here the position is there of the whole group, yeah, and that group is a single economic entity which consists of everyone, right? Every companies are there, joint ventures, associates, subsidiaries, holding is there, everyone is there. So that's a single economic entity, and that single economic entity cannot say that if holding doesn't pay, I will have to pay. Yeah, that sentence, that language cannot work in consolidation. Here it's just that group has to pay 5,000, simple as that. 3,000 outside, yeah, third party, and this new third party also of 2,000, yeah, that entire 5,000 has to be paid. So what is happening? Contingent liability has to be eliminated, this 2,000 has to be eliminated, and it's like that 2,000 is being rotated off to, it's being converted, it's being materialized into actual liability, bills payable 5,000. Is that clear? But the basic funda, the basic shortcut is what? Whatever that is common, eliminate. Contingent liability minus, that's all. Okay, that's all you have to do. If you want to be robotic, if you want to be, you know, what do you say, mechanical, then what you will do? Whatever that is common, eliminate that, contingent liability reduced, over, period. Yeah, whatever that is common, just delete that, and then contingent liability reduced. Yeah, and don't touch BR and BP, don't touch BR and BP as regards to that 2000, as regards to that contingent liability, just at the below, just reduce that. Is that clear? This is the whole concept of contingent liability and bills of exchange of what? Of intra-group transaction. Okay, now in the next video we have to see regarding debtor and creditor, okay, cash in transit concept. And loan, you directly understood, right? There is not much over there, just subtract that. Yeah, contra elimination, fine. And then regarding this intra-group transaction, there's one more thing, unrealized profit, which we will see after debtor and creditor, okay? Unrealized profit, because here, see, in consolidated financial statements, all effects of common transaction should be eliminated by each other, not just the balances, bills receivable, bills payable, debtor and creditor, yeah, loan given, loan taken, no, not just the balances in balance sheets, but also the profits, yeah? If some stock, yeah, if goods are purchased and sold, and if it is sold at higher, you know, loaded prices, then that loaded prices, from that you have to remove the profits element, okay? So we'll see that in coming videos, okay? So you understood regarding this, right? Intra-group transaction, asset and liability, just they need to be cancelled, right? Okay, fine. So that's it for this video. I hope you have got this, yeah? I have simplified this like no one else does, all right? Okay, then see you in the next video, yeah? Bye.